Welcome to another episode of Perfectly Healthy and Toned Radio. I am your show host, Darren Fatman McDuffie, and today we have a conclusion of a previous episode, whether or not a conclusion, but just the same subject. I did a episode on fermentation a little while back with another guest, and today we're discussing Wild Fermentation, which is a book by Sandor Katz. This is something that I'm very interested in, just simply because I'm going to be incorporating a lot of these things into my diet recently. Recently, I've had some digestive issues and want to improve my digestion to where it's kind of running real smoothly, so to speak. So again, we'll discuss Wild Fermentation with Sandor Katz. But before we do, let me read Sandor's bio. Sandor Katz is a fermentation revivalist, a self-taught experimentalist who lives in rural Tennessee. His explorations in fermentation develop out of overlapping interests in cooking, nutrition, and gardening. Wild Fermentation, originally published in 2003, along with his The Art of Fermentation and the hundreds of fermentation workshops he has taught around the world, have helped to catalyze a broad revival of the fermentation arts. Newsweek called Wild Fermentation the fermenting Bible, and the New York Times called Sandor one of the unlikely rock stars of the American food scene. Without further ado, Sandor Katz, Wild Fermentation. Enjoy. Sandor Katz, welcome to Perfectly Healthy and Toned Radio. How are you today?
I am great. Thanks so much for having me on your podcast.
All right. Thank you for being here. And I'm really excited to discuss your book, Wild Fermentation. But before we get into talking about the gist of the book, can you tell us your story? I usually ask everyone to kind of give us their story and how they got into what they're doing. And yours is very interesting, so I wanted you to share with the audience.
Okay, sure thing. I am the author of a couple of books about fermentation. I really just sort of like fell into an obsession with fermentation. In 1993, so 23 years ago, I moved from New York City, which was my hometown, to a community in rural Tennessee. I had a career in municipal government in New York City, but I was at a moment where I kind of was ready for a big change in my life. The biggest sort of, you know, catalyst that was making me feel that way was that I tested HIV positive in 1991, and it just, you know, sort of changed my perspective about, you know, sort of everything, my career, my life. And after about a year and a half of searching, I met some people from this community. I was very intrigued. I went and I visited, and I decided to try living on a rural community in Tennessee. And as soon as I moved down here and got involved in keeping a garden, that really became a central focus, was growing food and feeding people. And I was such a naive city kid that it had never really occurred to me that in a garden, all of your cabbage would be ready around the same time, or all of your radishes would be ready around the same time. So the first time I was faced with this, practical aspect of, food production and agriculture, I decided to learn how to make sauerkraut. I was familiar with sauerkraut. I loved sauerkraut as a kid, so I learned how to make sauerkraut, and, you know, very quickly I moved on to making yogurt, country wines, which would be wines from elderberries, blackberries, other kinds of fruits. I started keeping a sourdough and baking bread with it, and I just kind of got obsessed with all things fermented, and a few years, that built into a reputation among my friends and neighbors. I got invited to teach some sauerkraut making workshops. Doing that at an annual event for several years led me into writing a little booklet about fermentation that I self-published, mm-hmm. like a zine. And then as soon as I did that, I realized, oh, this would be a really interesting and good thing to write a book about. There's lots of information, but it's spread you know, in lots of different kinds of books, and there's nothing really pulling it all together. So I wrote a book. And of course, writing the book opened up more doors for teaching about it. And, you know, now I sort of find myself in the position of being an itinerant teacher about fermentation. And I travel around, you know, the United States and elsewhere, you know, lecturing and giving workshops on fermentation.
Yeah. You describe yourself in the book as having a fermentation fetish.
Sure. yeah, at the time that I wrote the book, that's how I described myself. As things have evolved, I these days I refer to myself as a fermentation revivalist. Mm-hmm. But you know, I meant fetish in the sense of iconic objects. So fermentation was something is something, you know, kind of bigger than us. And just to get into fermentation, I mean, let me just lay it out a little bit. But, you know, fermentation is the transformative action of microorganisms. Many, many, many foods and beverages that people around the world eat are transformed by fermentation. Almost every individual in almost every part of the world eats and drinks products of fermentation every day. For some of us, that might start with a cup of coffee in the morning. Coffee is fermented. Bread is fermented, cheese is fermented, cured meats are fermented, all the condiments that we love to put on our food are either directly fermented, as in soy sauce and fish sauce, or else they use vinegar, which is a product of fermentation, in order to stabilize them. Chocolate is fermented, vanilla is fermented, certain varieties of tea are fermented, of course beer and wine and ciders and any alcoholic beverages are fermented, sauerkraut, kimchi, pickles are fermented. According to one scholar of fermentation, one third of all food that human beings put into our mouths is transformed by fermentation before we eat it. So it is very, very widespread. And, while I certainly don't have encyclopedic knowledge, I've been looking for a long time for counterexamples, culinary traditions that do not incorporate fermentation, and I have not come up with a single one.
In your book, you describe yourself as a generalist more so than an expert. Explain that statement.
Well, I got interested in fermentation in the broader context of, you know, moving from an urban life to a rural life that was actually off the grid. And so I was learning lots of, you know, kind of homesteading skills, you know, how to fell a tree and cut firewood and heat with wood, how to patch up the water system, how to grow food for people and preserve it. So, you know, it was in this sort of broader context that I began my investigations of fermentation. And I would say that my knowledge of fermentation is really a generalist knowledge. I mean, let's just say that there are thousands of brewers in the United States and, you know, many more thousands around the world that know much more about brewing beer than I do. There are bakers, in every bakery who spend hours every day baking bread, and they know more about baking bread than I do. You could take any Indian family where they're making dosa or idli, things that I like to make and teach people how to make, but people who grew up doing it and do it every day, every week, just as part of their practice in the household, know more about it than I do. So, you know, rather than being an expert on any one of these, you know, very disparate styles of fermentation, I'm a generalist. I can connect a lot of dots. I know a little bit about a lot of different kinds of foods and beverages, but I think that the context of that is, I'm a generalist.
Yeah, I would say you probably know a lot about a lot of different things, but like you said, to me, you're an expert because I know very little about fermentation, but I get exactly what you're saying. When it comes to, I wanted to kind of go back, you know, before we had Wi-Fi, before we had internet and all these other things. And in the book, I kind of came up with a question because it said something along the lines of farming, harvesting and farming. And sometimes you can get in these periods of where you have an overabundance or a surplus of crops, and then sometimes you have a scarcity of crops. Do you think that fermentation was actually brought about as a way to kind of maybe fortify your eating in those lean times? For instance, if you had an overabundance of crops or whatever, meat or whatever it is, the way to kind of save that for a rainy day, so to speak, would be to ferment it. And I guess I'm asking if you think that's why fermenting was actually, or fermentation process was actually invented.
Well, I mean, first of all, let me say that, well, on one level, yes, absolutely. I mean, one of the most important practical applications of fermentation is food preservation. Mm-hmm. And I would go so far as to say that agriculture would not be possible without fermentation, because, you know, a group of people can't invest all of their energy into crops that are ready at certain moments of the year unless they have strategies for preserving those crops to get them through the rest of the year. You know, agriculture always, you know, comes in waves, where there are periods when a lot of things are ready and other periods where there's not a lot of fresh food to eat. So preservation has been a really important application of fermentation. And, you know, cheese is an example of milk preserved by fermentation. Cured meats are examples of meat preserved through fermentation. Pickles and sauerkraut and kimchi are examples of vegetables preserved by fermentation. And really, you know, if you take out refrigeration, which is a phenomenon of the last 100 years, and if you take out canning, which is a phenomenon of just the last 200 years, then fermentation was one of the only ways that people had to preserve food, in addition to drying it. But in terms of your question about fermentation being invented, I think it's really important to recognize that humans did not invent fermentation. Fermentation happens spontaneously without us. You know, anyone who picks a lot of berries observes that, you know, sometimes the berries are already fermenting just as a spontaneous natural occurrence, because yeast is everywhere. And yeast finds its way to the fruit, and as soon as the skins are damaged in any way, the yeast will begin to ferment the fruit. So fermentation is a natural phenomenon, and there's you know, lots of interesting evidence of different kinds of insects and birds and animals being drawn to the smell of fermenting fruit, you know, and even of animals gorging themselves on fermented fruit and becoming inebriated. You know, if we think about our evolutionary history, I mean, somehow we evolved with enzymes to be able to digest alcohol. So, you know, it suggests that our, you know, evolutionary forebears were familiar with the phenomenon of fermentation. You know, really what the human, you know, cultural achievement is not inventing fermentation, but it's creating vessels so that we can, you know, bring fermentation from being this sort of natural phenomenon that happens on its own terms to something where we can make it happen inside of a vessel.
Yeah. And you mentioned in the book, fermentation is everywhere. And you talk about, you know, just the act of breathing, that we are breathing and sharing, I guess, space with different microorganisms, different bacteria, different viruses, and all of those other things. So actually, in all actuality, fermentation is everywhere. It's just that we tend to notice it more when we're eating sauerkraut or kimchi or those other things. Speaking of, you mentioned cheese, and one of the things that I've encountered, and I'm sure that you probably encountered as well, is when you are in what we're doing, actually trying to educate people to bring them things that are more healthy, sometimes things come under fire. And I know in the book that they were talking about the essence of raw cheese, and that came under fire by the FDA. How common is this of an occurrence to actually have something associated with something that's been fermented? I guess it would be, I want to say botulism, or you know, some other microbe where they actually, something's out there where they're telling you not to eat these fermented foods.
Yeah, sure. I would say that because the earliest triumphs of the, you know, very young field of microbiology involved identifying pathogenic bacteria, disease-causing bacteria, that in the popular imagination, bacteria have become associated primarily with danger, disease, and death. And so, you know, especially for all of us who were raised in the 20th century, you know, we approach bacteria with fear and with suspicion because we've been indoctrinated our whole lives about how dangerous bacteria can be. So, you know, the prospect of cultivating bacteria, you know, in a jar of cabbage or in a jar of milk seems scary to people. And it's very easy for us to project our fear on that, and you know, and that goes for you know, regulatory authorities as well. I mean, in fact, fermentation really is a strategy for safety as much as anything else. You know, stepping away from milk, animal products have their own, you know, unique set of risks. But in the realm of you know, vegetable fermentation, sauerkraut, kimchi, and such. According to the U.S. Department of Agriculture, there has never been one single case of food poisoning documented from fermented vegetables. There's very few foods that you could say that about, and that's a really extraordinary safety record. It suggests that the process of fermentation makes vegetables safer than they are when they are raw, because every year we hear about outbreaks of, you know, different food-borne diseases through raw vegetables, you know, lettuce, spinach, tomatoes. You know, it always has to do with, you know, generally contamination in the field. But even if you took vegetables that had been contaminated like that, if you ferment them, the indigenous population of bacteria will always dominate. As they acidify the environment, they kill off anything that we would regard as a pathogen. You mentioned botulism. Mm-hmm. There's no case history of botulism. The reason we know the word botulism is because of canning. And the, you know, unique environment of a vacuum that you create inside of a sterilized jar is sort of uniquely hospitable to the bacteria that causes botulism. But in the normal aerobic environment where we all live, botulism is not, you know, really of a major concern. You know, as far as raw milk cheeses, I mean, animals can be healthy and animals can be unhealthy. And certainly, you know, our mainstream agricultural practices of, you know, factory farming and animals that, you know, rarely, if ever, see pasture, you know, results in unhealthy herds. And they can produce milk that can be unhealthy. So there is this safety concern with raw milk. But, you know, the milk of healthy animals with adequate access to pasture is generally healthy milk. And, you know, throughout the history of milk and cheese making, people have made milk out of raw milk cheese. You know, they still are doing that. And it's even fairly widespread in the U.S. It just means a higher, you know, in order for that to be safe, we just need a higher higher standards for our farms. You know, we need our animals to have access to adequate pasture. And, you know, you have to start with healthy milk if you want to make healthy cheese.
Yeah. Talking about the immune system, I know you yourself, you're HIV positive, and obviously when you have any type of disease, more so it's kind of suppresses the immune system, or you have immune system suppression. How do fermented foods actually help with building the immune system? Because I think all of us can do something with building our immune system, just simply because we're kind of disease phobic. Every time you look around, you see antibacterial. So I had a situation a couple of days ago after my uncle's funeral, where I was going in the door, we have something called a repast where they serve food and whatnot after the funeral. And I'm going in and there's a guy standing at the door waiting this squirt antibacterial soap in my hand, and I declined it. And he looked at me like I was crazy. But how, again, do these fermented foods actually help maybe build our immune system up a bit more?
Sure. Well, first of all, let me just point out that just the other day, the FDA has issued a new rule outlawing most of the chemicals that are used in antibacterial soaps.
Yes, I saw that.
You know, so they have come to the conclusion that, you know, contrary to making people healthier, you know, the regular consumer use of these kinds of soaps actually makes us more vulnerable to bacterial illnesses. Let me talk a little bit about some of the roles of bacteria in our bodies. So, you know, contrary to the war on bacteria thinking that bacteria are so dangerous for us, you know, it turns out that the cells of our bodies are outnumbered in our bodies by bacteria that we are host to. And these bacteria are not, they're not parasites. They're not even freeloaders. Actually, they give us a huge amount of our functionality. So our ability to effectively digest food and assimilate nutrients comes from bacteria in our bodies. Bacteria in our bodies synthesize essential nutrients for us, so we don't have to find them in our food. What we call our immune system is mostly the work of bacteria in our intestines. We're learning that serotonin and other chemical compounds that affect our brain function, how we think and how we feel, are regulated by bacteria in our intestines. The ability of the cells of our livers to regenerate is regulated by bacteria in our intestines. Almost every aspect of our, physical bodies and our functionality is related to bacteria. Now, in the war of bacteria, between antibacterial cleansing products, antibiotic drugs, chlorine that's put in the water to kill bacteria, you know, we all have pretty regular exposure to chemical compounds that kill bacteria, and they don't kill all the bacteria, but the way I think about it is they diminish biodiversity inside us. Usually, we think about biodiversity is something out there, something that has to do with, trees and, wolves and whales. And it does. It has to do with all those things. But it also has to do with the inside of our bodies. And we are going through a period of diminished biodiversity. And a lot of the, sort of emerging epidemic diseases, you know, relate to the loss of biodiversity in our gut. So I think that one of the main potential benefits of eating and drinking fermented foods and beverages is their probiotic value. They're the bacteria in them that can help to promote greater biodiversity in our bodies. Now, not every fermented food or beverage has living bacteria. Anything that has been cooked or heat processed after its fermentation no longer has living bacteria. If you buy a can of sauerkraut at the supermarket, that's been heat processed. Even though it was bacteria rich to begin with, the heat processing kills the bacteria. So it's really a subset of fermented foods, live culture foods. You know, I would say the most available of them would be fermented dairy products like yogurt and kefir, fermented vegetables like sauerkraut and kimchi, lightly fermented beverages like kombucha or ginger beer or mabi. All of these are foods and beverages that have biodiverse communities of bacteria in them that can help to restore biodiversity, which can help our immune function, help our digestion, help our mental health, and potentially many other aspects of our well-being.
Yeah. Do you think we've kind of done ourselves a disservice by being so bacteriophobic?
Well, yes, absolutely. I mean, certainly hygiene is important. Certainly, learning that, we need to, wash our hands well after using the toilet and before preparing food. I mean, hygiene is important, but we need bacteria. We need exposure to diverse bacteria. There's a hypothesis that the rise in childhood allergies has to do with lack of exposure to bacteria. The way our immune systems develop and learn is through exposure to varied bacteria. Our attempts to protect ourselves from bacteria in general are generally, not very helpful to us.
Yeah. In the book, it's talked a little bit about Louis Pasteur, and I learned about him when I was in grade school in science, and they talked about how, his last name is connotated with pasteurization, which is where it came from. But also, I didn't know before actually reading your book and preparing for the interview was that he kind of studied these fermented foods. But it also seems like there's a catch-22 because we get the germ theory from him. I come from the pharmaceutical industry and everything is about germs and viruses and killing germs and viruses. But it seems like it's been a catch-22 because you had him on one end and really studying about these foods and fermented foods. But then on the other end, we seem to kind of extract out of what he studied to kind of invent a whole nother industry. Can you talk about that a little bit or give your opinion on that?
Yeah, sure. I mean, Louis Pasteur is a very interesting historical figure for sure. I mean, he is definitely credited with, definitively establishing for science that fermentation is a biological process, that it is the work of microorganisms. And, he first began his investigation of microorganisms, at the behest of a wine manufacturer. But then as he learned about bacteria, he studied other aspects of bacteria, including bacteria as vectors of disease. It would be naive for me to say that bacteria had no relationship to disease. I mean, obviously there's the potential for bacteria to make us sick. I think that, the question is, is it simply exposure to the bacteria or is it something more? Mm-hmm. So, one of the concepts that I have really come to believe is that our biodiversity largely protects us. And so, if we constantly are coming into contact with these chemical compounds that diminish biodiversity, we're actually becoming more vulnerable to disease. Let me put it another way. All those antibacterial soaps that are beginning to be outlawed, or where they're proposing regulations that would make these chemical additives not permitted to be included in soaps. They always advertise themselves on the basis of, this soap kills 99.9% of bacteria. Mm-hmm. And that's about the sexiest thing that you could write on a container of soap, is promising people that it'll kill 99.9% of bacteria. But the thing is, what do you think protects us from the 0.1% of bacteria that can make us sick? It's the 99% of bacteria that we coexist with that create this extremely competitive environment that makes it extremely difficult for the pathogenic bacteria to establish themselves. But if we're continually killing off the 99.9% of bacteria with these kinds of products, we make our environment less competitive and thereby make ourselves more vulnerable to bacterial infection. So yes, bacteria are real. Yes, there do exist bacteria that can make us sick. But the best thing that can protect us from that is healthy communities of bacteria that we live with well, that are part of our body. So, I think that the strategy of always trying to kill off the bacteria around us is, really a counterproductive strategy. And we need to be thinking more about, cultivating bacteria that can keep us healthy.
Yeah. My background is in antibiotics, is what I sold, and it was years ago, but I just remember how quickly bacteria adapt. they adapt really, really quickly. And then we are always constantly pushing them away from us. We're kind of missing out on something that I think could really be helpful for us. And like you said, a lot of people are so afraid of bacteria. But again, we have a lot of children who have allergies, and that's because they're not being exposed to the bacteria that they're supposed to be exposed to. So it's kind of a catch 22. I've been dying to ask you this question. In the book, it talked about how fermented foods actually help with the diarrhea. But I'm going to kind of flip that and ask you, does it help with constipation? Because you have a lot of people don't have a problem in the States with diarrhea. Most people have a problem with actually pooping. They can't poop. So do fermented foods actually help with making people more regular?
Well, I mean, I hear you. I mean, definitely in our society, the biggest digestive complaint is constipation and slow digestion. And yes, I mean, live culture, bacteria rich fermented foods can definitely help improve digestion. And I want to make really clear to you and your listeners that, I am not a clinician. I don't like sort of see people with health problems and make prescriptions for their health problems. But because I talk to so many people about fermented foods and beverages, I get to hear lots and lots of anecdotal stories. And I have heard from, dozens and dozens of people that, when they started eating fermented foods or beverages, their chronic digestive problems went away. So I've heard that from people who just experienced chronic constipation, from people who have acid reflux problems, and often from people with more serious diseases like irritable bowel syndrome or other things. No promises that any particular, problem will be resolved by eating these kinds of foods. But I have consistently heard from people who lived for years with chronic digestive problems that this, significantly improved their, overall digestive process.
Yeah. When I've eaten them, I've had just noticed a little bit of improvement in my digestion process, more so being a little bit more regular. So I would definitely tell people if they have a problem with being regular.
And my observation is sort of the opposite, because I've been eating these foods for so long. But what I notice is when I'm in some situation traveling where I don't have access to any of these foods for a couple of days, mm-hmm. that my digestion slows down. So I have a very strong sort of personal experience that these foods just help keep my digestion functioning well.
Yeah. One thing that's been on the forefront for probably maybe 1 or 2 years is a substance called glutathione, which our bodies makes. But I was surprised that fermentation, the act of fermenting vegetables and consuming fermented food, it actually produces glutathione and superoxide dismutase. I know you're not a scientist, but I was just surprised at that we have all these different foods and you can use a process like fermentation to produce glutathione, which is very, very helpful to our body.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know much about glutathione at all, but mm-hmm. Fermentation creates a lot of extraordinary compounds. They're mm-hmm. they're metabolic byproducts of the the action of the bacteria digesting nutrients in the food, and some of them are extraordinary. So, like fermented vegetables have these compounds called isothiocyanates, and they are regarded as anti-carcinogenic compounds that are actually produced by the bacteria during the fermentation. Another ferment, maybe a little bit more obscure in our part of the world, is a Japanese soybean ferment called natto. But there's a compound in natto that's gotten a huge amount of attention, and it's generally called natto kinase. And you can find supplements with this in any vitamin supplement store. But natto kinase is believed to digest the fibers that accumulate in our blood vessels and constrict our circulation. Fibrin, And so, you know, people with arteriosclerosis or other kinds of, you know, circulatory problems that have to do with clogged arteries, you know, basically the this byproduct of the natto fermentation helps break down these fibers building up in the blood vessels. So there's a lot of really, you know, interesting metabolic byproducts of fermentation that have some kind of, you know, therapeutic value.
Yeah. And you can pretty much ferment anything. I wanted to kind of get into some practical things to do when you first start fermenting. But I saw in the book where you actually fermented goat meat. Talk about that experience, because when I think about fermentation, I think about sauerkraut. I think about kombucha, of course, because kombucha has pretty much exploded. You see it everywhere. But you don't normally think about fermenting meat itself. But talk about your experience with fermenting the goat meat.
Well, I mean, so in Wild Fermentation, which I originally wrote in 2003, I had this one experience of, you know, kind of just playing around with trying to ferment some goat meat. But since then, I've done quite a bit of fermentation of meat. And, you know, anyone who's ever eaten salami has eaten fermented meat. Salami is fermented meat. It's raw fermented pork, you know, that can hang on a string in a delicatessen for months without refrigeration, you know, as a result of the fermentation, which preserves it. But I mean, that first experiment was pretty ad hoc. I mean, I basically took little pieces of goat meat and, you know, put them in. I mixed all the different ferments I had around. So it was a mixture of wine and yogurt and miso and sauerkraut juice. I just mixed all these things together and put goat meat in it. You know, as you read the story in the book, I mean, it smelled pretty strong and cheesy, and you know, we had to open the windows. Some people didn't like the smell, but the taste was actually delicious, and the meat was very tender. You know, fermentation can lead to, you know, extreme flavors and extreme aromas, but also fermentation can, you know, think of cheeses. So you know, almost all cheese is fermented, but, you know, some cheeses have more mild kinds of flavors, and some cheeses have really these, like, very stinky, pronounced, you know, edgy kinds of aromas and flavors that remind people of decomposition. And the same thing happens with the fermentation of fish or meat. But fermented meat is simply part of the landscape. I mean, you know, anybody, you know, almost anybody who eats meat sometimes has eaten fermented meat. And, you know, salami is the most specific one that's widely known, but really, in a sense, all hams involve fermentation too, because, you know, they involve aging. And one of the things that's happening while it's aging is microbial transformation. But basically, nothing that could nourish us cannot be fermented. Any food can be fermented, which doesn't mean every food has, you know, equally well-established traditions of fermentation, but any food we could eat can be fermented.
Yeah. I remember my first experience going into a Whole Foods. I remember going where they keep all the cheese, and I'm like, what is that smell? I didn't know, because I was so used to buying cheese, the cheese slices, imitation cheese. I never really smelled any real cheese. That was my first experience with you know, experiencing that real cheese smell. So I was like, okay, what is that? Why does this smell so strong? And now, you know, now I know. But I wanted to ask you this, because I know that recently there's been a lot of discussion on probiotics, and we need more probiotics in our diet. A lot of people are having digestive problems. Is it better to combine fermented foods and probiotics, or if you're eating fermented foods like you do on a regular basis, is there any need to even take probiotics?
Well, from my perspective, fermented foods are probiotics.
Yes.
And, you know, all traditional fermented foods involve these broad communities of organisms, and they actually are embodiments of biodiversity, much more so than most probiotic capsules. So certainly there's no problem with doing both. But probiotics are expensive, and I actually think that you know, for my money, I'd rather invest in good quality food, and you know, or food that is easy to make yourself, and get you know, the greater biodiversity that's found in live fermented foods rather than capsules.
Yeah. Now, I wanted to take the last minutes or a couple of minutes of the interview and kind of get into the whole mechanics of fermenting. From what I can grasp from, you know, seeing different stuff on the internet, reading different books, I had yourself, your own now, and then I had someone on recently, and we talked about fermentation as well. It seems to me like the easiest thing to start with is sauerkraut. And then probably, I just discovered sauerkraut maybe 2 or 3 years ago myself, and I put it on a hot dog and I fell in love with it. But talk about what might be the easiest thing from your perspective. You've been doing this a lot longer than I have. I haven't actually even dipped myself into doing it. I keep telling myself I'm going to do it and get the materials. But what's the easiest thing to start with, and what are some of the materials that you might need when you're first starting this process?
I almost always recommend sauerkraut as a first fermentation project. It doesn't have to just be cabbage. You can, you know, mix in any other kind of vegetables you like. I'm going to describe how to make sauerkraut. It'll take me about 30 seconds. It's okay. Incredibly easy. You chop vegetables. They can be very fine or coarse as you like. I like with root vegetables, I like to use a hand grater and grate them. But what you're trying to do is create surface area on the vegetables. Then you salt them, lightly salt them to taste. There's no magic number. It's not highly technical. It's always easier to add salt than subtract salt. So I like to salt lightly as I'm chopping the vegetables. And then at the end, I'll taste it and add more as necessary. The salt starts to pull water out of the vegetables. The environmental condition that we're trying to create when we make sauerkraut is getting the vegetables submerged under liquid, ideally their own juices. So the salt starts pulling liquid out of the vegetables. Then what I like to do is, after I'm finished chopping and grating, get in there with my hands and start squeezing the vegetables with some force. And what that does is it bruises the vegetables, it breaks down some cell walls, and helps release the juice faster. Once you can pick up a handful of it after a few minutes of squeezing, and you squeeze the handful of vegetables, and juice comes out like a wet sponge, then you're ready to put your vegetables into the vessel. You can season them with whatever kinds of spices you like. You can leave it plain, or you could add garlic, or you could add caraway seeds, or you could add turmeric and cumin. You could add dill, any kind of seasoning you like. Mix it all up together and stuff it in your vessel. Your vessel could be a jar. That's the easiest vessel that we all have sitting in our pantries. Or you could use a ceramic crock. You could use a wooden barrel. You could use a plastic bucket. You want to stay away from metal, because the salt can corrode metal and the acids that develop over time can corrode metal. And then you ferment it. And you want to make sure the vegetables are nice and submerged under juice. If there's not enough juice in the vegetables, add a little bit of water. Keep them submerged and give it 3 or 4 days, and then just taste a little bit and then press them back down. Give it a few more days, taste it again. You'll notice that the flavor gets stronger, more acidic as the days go on. There's no prescribed length of time. A lot of contemporary books say 2 or 3 days. Historically, a lot of people would do it for 6 or 8 months. It just all depends. The warmer it is, the faster the fermentation happens. There's no danger in this process, but, you know, there are things that can go wrong. Sometimes you'll get yeast or mold growing on the surface. If anything like that develops, just skim it off. If you let it go for a long time or the environment is very hot, the vegetables might start to get a little bit soft. If that's the work of enzymes, is there's nothing dangerous about it. When I first notice they're getting soft, I get them in the fridge to slow down that process and enjoy them. That's as simple as it is. Some people like it after 2 days. Some people like it after 2 weeks. The only way you can find out how long you'll like fermenting it is to, try it at different intervals and see. But this process is really easy. No recorded cases of food poisoning or illness, nothing to be fearful of. It's an incredibly wonderful way to, enjoy delicious vegetables through the winter, make every sandwich, wrap, or omelet probiotic as well. And just a terrific addition to any meal, really.
Yeah. Is there a different process for doing beverages? Because I know we talked a little bit earlier about kombucha, but is there a different process? I understand with sauerkraut you might be using salt, but is there something different when you are fermenting a beverage, a different material or a different process?
Well, there's a lot of different kinds of beverages. There are fermented vegetable beverages as well. A popular one called beet kvass comes from the Ukraine. But with something like kombucha, first of all, for kombucha, you need the mother of kombucha, a SCOBY, a symbiotic community of bacteria and yeast, which is the starter for making kombucha. It looks like a rubbery pancake, basically, that floats on top of sweet tea. Mm-hmm. But then the process is really easy. You just make some tea, cool it down, mix some sugar into it. Once it's body temperature, you add a little bit of mature kombucha, and then you float the SCOBY. And you need to use a vessel with a broad surface area, because the kombucha is an example of an aerobic ferment that needs oxygen. And then you just sort of cover it with a cloth and let it ferment for, you know, usually a week to 10 days. Develops a flavor that most people like. If you wanted to make a wine, or, you know, you would take grapes and crush them, or any kind of a fruit, and mix it with a sugar water solution, and just let the yeast and bacteria from the fruit develop in the sugary solution or in the fruit juice, and you don't use any salt in that case. So yeah, different ferments have different requirements. None of it is rocket science. People have been doing all of the major ferments are thousands of years old. So certainly in our home kitchens in the 21st century, we can do them. You just have to understand the environment you need to create, and that's what my books are all about. Wild Fermentation is my first book that came out in 2003, but I've just revised it, and the revised edition just came out within the last few weeks. And then I have another book called The Art of Fermentation that came out in 2012. That's a bigger and more thorough treatment of the topic. Both books are available on my website, wildfermentation.com, as is a schedule of my workshops and links to all kinds of fermentation-related resources.
Yeah. I had just two more questions for you. I'm going to keep you a little bit more. The first one is maybe integrating these with our meals. And to me, it's really easy, but I just ask a question for the audience out there, because usually when you have a meal, you kind of put, your string beans on the plate. I would imagine it's just like that with your fermented foods, but are there any things that are combinations that might go better with certain dishes? For me, I like to eat maybe lamb with potatoes or something like that. Is there any combinations that you find that are better, or is just pretty much wide open when it comes to integrating them?
Well, I think it's pretty wide open, but I mean, I think of fermented vegetables as almost like a condiment. So they can be a side dish, but they also can go great on a sandwich. Like you mentioned it on a hot dog, sauerkraut on a hot dog, but on any kind of a sandwich or any kind of a wrap, they're delicious. Or with anything. I mean, what I like to do is have different kinds of fermented vegetables. Lately I've been eating a sauerkraut that was cabbages and beets together. And then also I fermented some watermelon rinds. So then I also have these watermelon rind pickles. So, with different meals, I'll incorporate, different fermented vegetables, not really according to any, particular philosophy of food combining, but just based on, what's appealing to me, to eat together. This morning for breakfast, I had an omelet with a little bit of sauerkraut just on the side of the omelet.
Hmm. Yeah. Yeah. It just sounds like it's very easy to integrate. I think that, sometimes we put too much thought into it and I like to make things simple. So I'm like you, if I want to eat sauerkraut in the morning, I'll go ahead and eat sauerkraut in the morning on the side of something else. I don't really give it that much thought. It's like, oh, this doesn't go with this or whatever. It's just according to my taste. The last thing I wanted to ask you, Sandor, was I've never heard of this, and most of the time I know if I haven't heard of anything, and I've been kind of studying nutrition for 11 years, I more so know the layperson hasn't really heard of it either. So I wanted to ask you about, and it deals with corn, because I used to have really, you know, digestive issues with corn, and I kind of took it out of my diet. But there's a process that you describe. It doesn't have anything to do with fermentation, but there's a process that you described in your book called, and I can't even pronounce it, it's called
nixtamalization.
Nixtamalization. Yeah. Okay, you got it. But talk about that, because I think that for a lot of people who have issues with corn, this might be something that we're missing when it comes to partaking in corn, something that we may need to do. And this process comes from years and years ago from a different culture, but we know nothing about it today. Actually, when reading your book was the first time I ever heard of it. But talk a little bit about that and kind of expand on the audience's knowledge on it.
Sure. So the corn cultures of the Americas, and you know, corn is a crop that evolved first in Central America and then spread throughout North and South America. By the time the Spanish arrived in the Americas and brought it back to Europe, but most of the corn cultures of the Americas generally treated corn by cooking it with wood ashes or lye, and they use that as a way of removing the tough hulls from the corn. Mm-hmm. But it also altered the corn nutritionally. And changed the amino acid ratio of the corn and made it just much better nutrition for people. And nobody really knows how this, how this method developed in the first place. It's very, very widespread throughout the Americas. Indigenous people have worked with processes like these, and it just makes corn much more nutritious. In the southeastern United States, where I live in Tennessee, the word for this would be hominy. So when you hear about grits, they're usually hominy grits. Yes. But hominy traditionally is corn that's cooked with wood ash in the same process as nixtamalization. It just makes corn much more nutritious. And interestingly, outside of the Americas, when corn was exported from the Americas to Europe and Africa and elsewhere, places where it became a staple crop, but they did not, you know, bring this processing method with them, there was widespread pellagra, which is a nutritional deficiency disease. And this disease had never really been seen in the Americas because of this nixtamalization. And it's a very simple process. I mean, it's you basically sift some wood ash and, you know, briefly cook the corn with the wood ash. It changes color. The hulls loosen, or if you cook them long enough, dissolve. Actually, if you cook the corn long enough, the corn itself can dissolve. So it's generally a pretty brief process, and then you wash it really well to get rid of any residue of the ash. If you go to a Mexican market and you buy masa flour, this is flour of corn that has been treated with this process.
Cool. Yeah, I've never heard of that process. And you just mentioned hominy grits. I just had some of those while I'm here visiting my aunt in South Carolina. So I was wondering why I wasn't really getting any digestive issues, but I guess I know now why I wasn't getting any. But Sandor, thank you for being with me today. And I know you mentioned this before, but your book, I'm assuming, is going to be available on Amazon, Wild Fermentation, which is what we're discussing today. And do you have a website?
Yeah, sure. So my website is wildfermentation.com, and the books are also available on my website or Amazon or local bookstores, hopefully anywhere.
Okay. Again, Sandor, thank you for being me. It's been a pleasure, and I really enjoyed the interview.
Well, thank you so much. I enjoyed it too. Have a good day.
Thanks.
Point out the colors in you. I see them too. And boy, I like them. I like them. I like them. We're way too fly to partake in all this hate. We out here vibing. We vibing. We vibing.
Alexa, play Ariana Grande.
Okay.
With Amazon Music, a voice is all you need. Get tens of millions of songs. Download the Amazon Music app today.
Don't miss these Saturday steals at Old Navy. 50% off all jeans and all shoes, $5 graphic tees, and 40% off your entire purchase today at Old Navy and OldNavy.com. Saturday steals valid 11/17, 40% valid 11/15 to 11/20. Exclusions apply. See store for details.